Tonight on NewsWatch, embassy attacks and the election. How the recent violence is bringing foreign policy into the spotlight.
Plus, remembering a national hero, Neil Armstrong's memorial at the National Cathedral.
And Bosnia, 20 years later, how one woman is working to rebuild her nation two decades after war. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch.
U.S. embassies around the world are on guard. Good evening, everyone. I'm Wendy Griffith.
And I'm Lee Webb. At least seven countries are warning tonight of possible protests at U.S. embassies. This after the deadly riots in Libya that killed Ambassador Chris Stevens. Yemen is the latest place to see protests. Hundreds of demonstrators, as you can see here, took to the streets chanting anti-American slogans. Some managed to make it inside the gates of the U.S. Embassy in Yemen. Once inside, they tore down and burned the American flag, replacing it with one bearing Islam's declaration of faith. There is no God but Allah. More information now is coming out about the Libya attack that killed four Americans, including the American ambassador.
A senior security official in Libya says the violence may have been timed to mark the 9/11 anniversary.
It's also believed the militants used civilians protesting an anti-Muslim film as their cover. Heather Sells has the story tonight.
Many Libyans are taking to the streets to show their support for the U.S. and to protest the attack that killed four Americans. The U.S. is vowing to find those responsible.
As Americans, we stand united, all of us, in gratitude for their service. I want to assure you, we will bring their killers to justice.
The Libyan attack has led to anti-American turmoil and more violence. In Yemen, protesters stormed the U.S. embassy compound. And in Egypt, for the second day in a row, protesters are clashing with security forces outside the U.S. embassy. Many believe they're motivated by an anti-Muslim film on the internet.
It appears to have a deeply cynical purpose to denigrate a great religion and to provoke rage.
The president of Egypt has condemned the movie, but also says it cannot be used as a justification for attacking embassies. Back at home, the presidential candidates are shifting their focus to foreign policy. Mitt Romney is suggesting the president is weak and didn't react quickly enough to condemn the attacks on U.S. missions overseas.
The administration was wrong to stand by a statement sympathizing with those who had breached our embassy in Egypt instead of condemning their actions.
But the statement Romney referred to was a press release from the U.S. Embassy in Cairo that condemned anti-Islam sentiment, not the attackers. And the administration noted that the press release went out before the violence began.
You know, Governor Romney seems to have a tendency to shoot first, name later. And as president, one of the things I've learned is you can't do that.
However, the U.S. Embassy was still tweeting about the press release after the attacks. But with the situation in the Middle East continuing to unfold, the campaign barbs may be tempered. And the Obama campaign says it has no plans to air ads on the subject. Heather Sells, CBN News.
Con Carroll is a senior editorial writer with the Washington Examiner, and he joins us now to take a look at the political responses to this. Con, as we've reported, Mitt Romney is really coming under fire for his response to the Obama administration. Will this hurt him in the race for the White House?
If the narrative the media is playing continues, yes, it will, because they're attacking him for being partisan and political. But it's starting to change already. Already you're seeing more media ask whether or not Obama really was prepared for these attacks. And the evidence so far shows that he was not.
Instead of criticizing each other right now, why aren't the candidates using this situation to really focus on foreign policy?
Well, Obama doesn't want to have it focused on foreign policy. He wants to have it focused on Romney's statements. Because if people look about what happened, what they see is that his whole foreign policy in the Middle East, his support of the Arab Spring, his speech in Cairo that really put the onus on the Muslim world to come up and act democratically, just is not panning out. He was supposed to, the Arab world was supposed to love Obama and his policies after he apologized for Bush, and that clearly isn't happening, as these riots showed.
Well, should Obama have apologized right after that incident?
Well, what happened was is that the the embassy in Cairo put out a statement that the White House in D.C. disavowed, but the embassy stayed by it. So what you have is the official White House statement, the official embassy statement, saying that the First Amendment is not as important as protecting religion, which is exactly what the Islamists believe, but it's a denigration of American values. And so that really was what Romney was saying, is that Obama shouldn't betray American values by denigrating the First Amendment abroad.
Do you think any of the Obama administration's policies put these diplomats at greater risk? I mean, considering it was September 11th.
Absolutely. You had warnings throughout the region before the anniversary of 9/11 that there was going to be a probability of attacks. Obama himself said that we need to possibly have attacks and be on the lookout. But then Marines were not at the consulate in Benghazi. It wasn't until a day after that Obama ordered 50 Marines to go there. Why weren't they there a day before?
Good questions. Con Carroll with the Washington Examiner, thanks for being with us and sharing your insights.
Thank you so much for having me.
And there are new questions tonight about the film that's being blamed for provoking Muslims to anger. A 14-minute trailer of the movie called Innocence of Muslims was posted on YouTube. The online media outlets BuzzFeed and Gawker are raising questions about that trailer. They say nearly all the names of characters, including Muhammad's, appeared to be overdubbed, added after the movie was shot, in other words. Now one of the actresses in the movie is speaking out. She says the original script was so different from the trailer that none of the cast suspected what the movie was about.
There was never any mention of Muhammad or Muslims or anything like that in the film. I was just playing the role of a mother. I have the actual script. I have the title of the film, which was Desert Warriors. We were supposed to be playing a film of how life was 2,000 years ago and compared to today, you know, and that's what the film was supposed to be about.
Media watchers say the final product is either a very bad re-edit of the original script or an outright hoax.
Well, in economic news today, the Federal Reserve announces plans to spend $40 billion a month to help boost the weak economy. The money will go to buy mortgage-backed securities. The Fed says it will keep buying the securities until the job market shows substantial improvement. The Fed also extended a plan to keep short-term interest rates at record low levels through mid-2015. Well, Congress is passing a new six-month spending bill. The current fiscal year ends September 30th, and the measure is needed to avoid a government shutdown. The measure would continue a freeze on federal worker pay, but give federal agencies a 0.6% increase in funding. Republicans are against the spending hikes, but passed the temporary bill so Congress doesn't have to pass another spending bill in the post-election lame duck session.
Former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice is talking about her faith and politics with CBN News. David Brody interviewed Rice on this week's Brody File program. She also opened up about being single at the age of 58.
My life is terrific, and I just thank God every day for the life that He's given me, literally in those words. And sure, I'm a nice Southern girl. I assumed I'd get married. I just could never find anybody I actually wanted to live with, and you know that actually is a prerequisite for getting
That's
married.
What I've heard.
That's right. So I, you know, maybe someday I will, but my life feels complete. My life feels fulfilling. I work hard to practice my faith, and I think that God touches us in all kinds of packages. Some of us married, some of us single, but the important thing is to remember that God touches us all.
David, by the way, calls the show Politics Without the Snooze Factor, and you can watch the Brody File this Friday morning on the ABC Family Channel at 9:30 Eastern Time.
That's true. If anyone can make politics fun, it's David Brody.
That's right. Well, today our nation bid farewell to a real hero, Neil Armstrong. He made history in 1969 by becoming the first man to walk on the moon. Hundreds gathered at the National Cathedral to say goodbye. He died August 25th after suffering complications from a heart procedure. His memorial service was filled with hymns and scripture. The memorial precedes Armstrong's burial, which will be at sea and conducted by the Navy tomorrow. For more on the service and the tributes to Neil Armstrong, We invite you to go to cbnnews.com for the full story.
And coming up, what's on the minds of American voters this election year? Why some say social issues are the top concern.
A decorated veteran.
I love my country, and I love being free.
Discovers his greatest battle.
I kept thinking about my son.
Is much closer to home.
You are breaking the law.
That is a lie, and you know it.
Now, it's time to take a stand.
The drama just continues to unfold here.
And become a hero all over again.
We fight for freedom!
Last Ounce of Courage. This is freedom. Starts Friday at select theaters.
If you have diabetes and you're on Medicare, call now for a new pain-free meter. These new meters are more accurate, they're easier to use, and the best news is you don't have to prick your fingers anymore. Call now, and Arriva Medical will send you one of these new meters for free. And if you have Medicare, your testing supplies may also be covered. Arriva makes it simple. They bill Medicare directly. There are no upfront costs. And they deliver your supplies right to your door for free. With these new meters, there's no coding, you don't have to prick your fingers, and some of these meters even talk.
Your blood glucose reading is 122.
And if you call 1-800-284-9762, we will send you a free Betty Crocker Diabetes Cookbook filled with delicious recipes.
Call Arriva today. You'd be glad you did.
A decorated veteran.
I love my country, and I love being free.
Discovers his greatest battle.
I kept thinking about my son.
Is much closer to home.
You are breaking the law.
That is a lie, and you know it.
Now, it's time to take a stand.
The drama just continues to unfold here.
And become a hero all over again.
We fight for freedom!
Last Ounce of Courage.
This is freedom.
Starts Friday at select theaters.
Well, if you are thirsty enough to buy a big gulp soda in New York City, think again. Oversized sugary drinks are now banned from restaurants, concession stands, and other eateries there. That includes any non-diet soda, sweetened teas, or other caloric beverages served in containers larger than 16 ounces. The ban passed by the city's health board will affect fast food establishments, theaters, and workplace cafeterias. Officials say it's necessary to combat obesity, but critics argue it's just another big government intrusion.
Mm-hmm. Makes me thirsty, though. Well, students and teachers in Chicago public schools might be headed back to class Friday. Teachers went on strike Monday over the city's demand for tougher teacher evaluations. After late-night talks Wednesday, Chicago Teachers Union president says the system's offer on teacher evaluations had improved, and he is hopeful that a deal can be reached by Friday. Meanwhile, churches across the city have been opening their doors to help the children of the city. We spoke with Pastor Charles Lyons of Armitage Baptist Church. The church provided free school and meals for kids affected by the strike.
They were all identified by grade. We were ready to go with every grade, K up through 12, then assigned and grouped and taken to their class areas. We went around the community and just asked restaurants, look, this is what we're doing. Would you guys be interested in donating? So every day we've had a different restaurant feed our kids.
Obviously meant a lot to him and I'm sure to the students. Well, some 350,000 students have been out of class since that strike. Well, with the election drawing nearer, all eyes seem to be on the economy.
But the head of the Family Research Council says social issues will be a big factor in shaping the outcome of November. Paul Strand has more.
Tony Perkins says despite the general belief the economy is all that matters in this election, social issues like abortion and same-sex marriage will still be important to voters and still matter.
We also believe that if you want to strengthen the economy, you must first strengthen the American family.
And he says crucial swing states this year have tended to be pro-life and pro-traditional marriage in past elections.
Many of the states where pro-life action has been strongest are swing states.
What shocks him, Perkins says, is how vicious the debate has become about these contentious social issues. In one case, it led a gay man to enter the Family Research Council headquarters and begin shooting.
It's time to stop hurling labels of hate and have a legitimate debate about the policies that govern our nation.
Perkins revealed the gunman who wounded one employee before that worker tackled him had the potential to execute a massacre.
The man who shot Leo Johnson carried with him enough ammunition to kill over half the people in our office building that day.
He revealed FRC workers gathered an hour or so after the shooting and prayed for the gunman. Paul Strand, CBN News, Washington.
A new study indicates that most church-going Christians do not read the Bible every day. Lifeway Research finds that 90% of churchgoers agree with the statement, "I desire to please, honor, and honor Jesus in all that I do." But only 19% read the Bible every day. About 25% read the Bible a few times a week. 14% say they read the Bible once a week, and 22% say once a month or a few times a month. 18% rarely or never read the Bible.
Up next, a nation torn apart by war. How one woman is trying to heal her homeland 20 years later.
A decorated veteran.
I love my country, and I love being free.
Discovers his greatest battle.
I kept thinking about my son.
Is much closer to home.
You are breaking the law.
That is a lie, and you know it.
Now, it's time to take a stand.
The drama just continues to unfold here.
And become a hero all over again.
We fight for freedom!
Last Ounce of Courage. This is freedom. Starts Friday at select theaters.
If you have diabetes and you're on Medicare, call now for a new pain-free meter. These new meters are more accurate, they're easier to use, and the best news is you don't have to prick your fingers anymore. Call now, and Arriva Medical will send you one of these new meters for free. And if you have Medicare, your testing supplies may also be covered. Arriva makes it simple. They bill Medicare directly. There are no upfront costs, and they deliver your supplies right to your door for free. With these new meters, there's no coding, you don't have to prick your fingers, and some of these meters even talk.
Your blood glucose reading is 122.
And if you call 1-800-284-9762, we will send you a free Betty Crocker Diabetes Cookbook filled with delicious recipes.
Call Arriva today. You'd be glad you did.
A decorated veteran.
I love my country, and I love being free.
Discovers his greatest battle.
I kept thinking about my son.
Is much closer to home.
You are breaking the law.
That is a lie, and you know it.
Now, it's time to take a stand.
The drama just continues to unfold here.
And become a hero all over again.
We fight for freedom!
Last Ounce of Courage. This is freedom. Starts Friday at select theaters.
In the early and mid-1990s, ethnic and religious hatred boiled over in Bosnia. Muslims and Christians slaughtered each other in the streets. At least 200,000 people died.
So sad. Nearly two decades later, the ghosts of that war still linger. Now, one woman is on a mission to help heal the wounds of the past. George Thomas has this focus report from Sarajevo.
For over 1,400 days, they fought on the streets of Sarajevo. Neighbor against neighbor, loved one against loved one. What Catholic Croats, Orthodox Serbs, and Muslim Bosnians did to each other, in the name of ethnicity, in the name of religion, was simply awful. Rape, ethnic cleansing, genocide, cold-blooded murder. You name it, it happened. The fighting spread from the capital and soon engulfed the country. When the guns fell silent 3 years later, the horrors of what had happened shocked the world.
And the estimates are some 250,000 Bosnians slaughtered each other on the streets of Sarajevo, Mostar, Srebrenica, Banja Luka. We remember those cities and the events that played out in front of our television screens.
Now, 16 years later, with thousands missing, Bosnia remains haunted by memories of war. The ethnic and religious divisions still linger.
And now after the war, it's maintained and fed. And it could be a field, it could be fertile soil for another war.
Vanya Bule doesn't want to see war happen again.
We would like to see something different, leave something different as a heritage to our children.
So for the past several years, she's helped turn this piece of land, tucked in a valley and surrounded by mountains, outside the capital city of Sarajevo, into a place of reconciliation. For 4 weeks in the summer, she invites Croats, Serbs, and Muslims to a camp event like none other.
So many kids, teenagers, young people, even older people who come, they are so amazed at what they see, because they don't see it outside this place.
What they see and experience is a message of hope and love.
And they are drawn to it. They are drawn to the unity. They are drawn to the place where there's no pressure of ethnicity, but they can live a life in community, in fellowship, in love, experience one another.
You see, Vanya Bule is an evangelical Christian. She believes Christ is the answer for Bosnia.
As we pray, may your kingdom come and your will to be done in this place, is our only hope. Not just for eternity, but to live this earthly life, because we may have another war. So we need Jesus to change our reality.
Vanya is from Croatia. She moved to Bosnia several years ago to be a missionary. She earned a Master of Divinity from Regent University in Virginia.
And when I came to Regent, I came with a deep conviction and a calling to come back to my country, to get everything I needed to do and have and come back.
Now she runs Emek Baraka, a ministry that helps organize the summer outreach programs. Emek Baraka is Hebrew, meaning Valley of Blessing.
To have these people come, you touch them, you impart into them. Then they go home to the north, to the west, to the east, to the south, and they bring what they received here. And in building them, we build the nation.
When I leave here, I can tell others in my school that it is possible to live together.
I attended this camp for the first time 9 years ago, and it changed my life. I saw how Jesus Christ can transform your heart and attitude towards others.
The camp is also a strategic time for Bosnia's evangelical community, and here's why.
You see, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ here in Bosnia is not easy. This is, after all, a land dominated by the Catholics, Orthodox, and Muslims. And the evangelical church, well, they number less than 700 in the entire country.
It's an opportunity for all the leaders to come together, fellowship, and encourage one another. We pray for revival. We pray for each other. It really is a time to recharge and be refreshed by God.
Organizing the camp is not without its share of challenges. There's no hot water, no proper toilets. Campers have to sleep in tents. There are no buildings on the property, except for this bombed-out shell of a structure that serves as the kitchen and feeds hundreds.
Every year again, fixing that bombed-down kitchen, trying to fix it so it's somewhat usable.
She has a dream to one day build a real kitchen and new dormitories so they can hold additional camps throughout the year. For now, though, she continues to pray that this valley can be a blessing to the nation.
When I see this place, when I see the children that I see divided in the cities of Bosnia, when I come to this place and I see them playing the same games, when I see them sitting next to each other, when I see them worshiping the same God, when I see them, and I don't see ethnic groups, I see people of Bosnia and Herzegovina. I see a future generation who might, just might, have a different future.
George Thomas, CBN News, Sarajevo, Bosnia.
Up next, From household pest to crime fighter, believe it or not, how the common cockroach may soon help police and first responders.
A decorated veteran.
I love my country, and I love being free.
Discovers his greatest battle.
I kept thinking about my son.
Is much closer to home.
You are breaking the law.
That is a lie, and you know it.
Now, it's time to take a stand.
The drama just continues to unfold here.
And become a hero all over again.
We fight for freedom!
Last ounce of courage. This is freedom. Starts Friday at select theaters.
If you have diabetes and you're on Medicare, call now for a new pain-free meter. These new meters are more accurate, they're easier to use, and the best news is you don't have to prick your fingers anymore. Call now, and Arriva Medical will send you one of these new meters for free. And if you have Medicare, your testing supplies may also be covered. Arriva makes it simple. They bill Medicare directly. There are no upfront costs. And they deliver your supplies right to your door for free. With these new meters, there's no coding, you don't have to prick your fingers, and some of these meters even talk.
Your blood glucose reading is 122.
And if you call 1-800-284-9762, we will send you a free Betty Crocker Diabetes Cookbook filled with delicious recipes.
Call Arriva today. You'd be glad you did.
A decorated veteran.
I love my country, and I love being free.
Discovers his greatest battle.
I kept thinking about my son.
Is much closer to home.
You are breaking the law.
That is a lie, and you know it.
Now, it's time to take a stand.
The drama just continues to unfold here.
And become a hero all over again.
We fight for freedom!
Last ounce of courage. This is freedom. Starts Friday at select theaters.
Well, a hated household pest may prove actually to be a hero.
And it's all thanks to the folks from North Carolina State's Wolf Pack. Believe it or not, university engineers there are outfitting cockroaches with tiny computer chip backpacks. The device can control the insect's path and be fitted with a microscopic camera and microphone. Scientists hope to use the bugs in hostage situations and search and rescue operations.
Time is very critical. We had a golden hour for the person who was injured, for the survivability rate.
An insect thinks that there's an obstacle in front and it tries to avoid it.
Works by stimulating the cockroach's antenna. And despite objections from some animal rights groups, scientists stress the insects have neither feelings nor pain sensors. What a clever
interesting
thing to be able to go into hostage situations.
Hope nobody would go in there and step on it, you know, during the
right, that
experiment.
Would kind of defeat the purpose, wouldn't it? But at least a good use for a cockroach.
Yeah, absolutely. But you could also see some military use for it, too.
Absolutely.
Or police, you know, to get in there.
Or undercover journalist
absolutely.
Work.
Yeah.
Maybe not.
Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thanks so much. Remember, you can email us your comments and questions at newswatch@cbn.com. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.